Good morning. Welcome to worship. Why don't we stand together? Let's lift our voices this morning. 2 Chronicles 20:15, the Spirit of the Lord came upon a man named Jahaziel, and he spoke the word and said, all of these things that are coming against us, you don't have to be dismayed. You don't have to be worried or concerned in the midst of the armies that were coming to attack Judah. He says, the battle is not yours. It's the Lord's. Let's declare that as the body of Christ this morning, that the battle belongs to the Lord. Listen to this first verse as Lobby leads, and I'll ask you to sing in a moment.
All I see is the battle. You see my victory.
There's nothing to fear now. Let's sing this together. When I fight.
So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Every fear I lay at your feet. I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you.
Amen. The battle belongs to the Lord. Let's sing this verse together.
If you are for me, who can be against me? For Jesus, there's nothing impossible for you. When all I see are the ashes, you see the
stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadow. You win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God.
Almighty fortress.
Oh,
to Him. We don't have to fight it on our own. But in Christ, we can have victory in the midst of that battle. This morning, as we see Christ, let's open our eyes. Open the eyes of our hearts to Him. Open the eyes.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you high lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power.
Men sing holy. Turn to worship this morning to see the Lord. Would you be seated where you are?
We'll be right back. brings back some really good memories and good times that we've had over the last couple of weeks. Some of you may or may not know, but the last 2 weeks of July, you were able to send a team to serve with Surrey Chapel Church in Norwich, England for about 2 weeks. And during the process of those 2 weeks, we were able to serve alongside them as they hosted a day in the park. They called it a vacation Bible school. They call it a holiday club. They use the word vacation and holiday kind of like we do there. But we had a great opportunity to come alongside them, to share, to love on them, and they loved on us as well. So we are so thankful for the opportunity, and thank you as a church for helping us get there to be able to do that. And so that video was just a short glimpse of some of the things that we got to do. And as I told these two a while ago, some of that stuff was not supposed to make it back to America, but it did. And Bob Harrington, you see, does have some rhythm, and Bob Harrington and Miss Charlotte Mitchell shared in our first service this morning. And so this particular service, I've asked Kimberly Bradshaw and Tim Hodges just to come share just a brief testimony about what the Lord taught them over the last couple of weeks, and so that you could hear from them what it was that God did that week. Kimberly, you're first.
Yes, I definitely asked to go ahead of Tim. Tim's funny, and I was like, I don't want to follow somebody that's funny. I'm a little more serious. Okay, so thank you for the church, for supporting us, for praying for us, and just being there for us and allowing us to go and do this. Thank you, Pastor Greg. We had some training sessions where we were taught to be fat. Uh-huh. Yeah, taught us to be fat. Uh-huh. And that means flexible, available, and teachable. So the whole time we were gone, be fat, okay. No complaining, okay. So Pastor Gray did tell us that we were going to be herding cats. Little did he know that it would be more his job of herding us, you know, on the train and all that kind of stuff. So some things that really happened were just amazing. From the start of where God just told Michael one day to take his credit cards out of his phone, where he kept them in his phone and put them in his real wallet, and that day he lost his phone. So, you know, that's a God thing. As soon as we got back, we got a new phone, and everything had backed up to the cloud, so everything's fine. So, but you know what? It was nice for him not to have that phone while we were gone, so God took care of everything. The tour, Pastor Greg did a little tour for us, signed us up for a tour. That was one of the most meaningful things for me. I wish I could have in writing everything that he said on our tour, but one of the things that I got through the jet lag, we were so tired trying to listen and understand, was that all of our predecessors in Christianity planted seeds. Some of them got to see them come to bear, some of them did not. So the whole thing about our trip was remembering to plant seeds. And don't worry about if you get to see them to come to bear or not. So one of mine and Michael's jobs were to host in the cafe. We had a makeshift tent where we would offer coffee and tea to people in the park. It was wonderful. And my job was to talk to people, to get to know people, to ask them questions and visit with them and get to pet their animals. They had some wonderful puppy dogs I enjoyed petting. So I had a great time getting to know the people and visiting with them and planting those seeds, because there's so many that are unchurched, that are not going to church anywhere. The people of the church, though, were so warm and welcoming. I felt like I left a piece of my heart over there. I made some connections over there with people, with Pastor Andy and his wife Grace and the rest of the church members. Oh, treasure forever the memories that we have with them. And Pastor Greg told me before we left, he said, okay, you're going to be staying with Mr. Derek, okay? Mr. Derek, come to find out, was a math teacher who taught math teachers how to teach math. Not only was he a math teacher, but he actually wrote textbooks. Yes, he's also known as a doctor. He had his doctorate degree, and he was the minister of music for that church for 30 years, who had recently lost his wife 3 months ago. Y'all, the man opened up his home and showered us with love and acceptance. The day we left, I cried.
Michael cried because he will forever be in our heart. I miss him every day. Begun to find out, I would come home every night talking to him about Vacation Bible School, Summerfest, Holiday Club. He said, well, you know that I started that. I said, no. Yes, he started it in the church a long time ago, and then he would reminisce and tell us memories of all that he has done. Even in his time of pain and grieving, he still wanted to be serving the Lord. What a testimony. Thank you, Pastor Greg. Thank you, church. And thank you, Surrey Church. We love y'all.
Have to follow that. Anyway, so have y'all ever heard that phrase, country comes to town? They sent me with a bunch of hayseeds to London. But I survived. It was actually a great trip, and that Christian Heritage Tour really was the highlight of London for me. And something Ben, the tour guide, said was, all these cathedrals are a distraction to the gospel. And we have those here in Ellisville. I've been thinking about that a lot. What's a distraction in my life to the gospel? As far as Norwich, the people there was, I mean, from day one, they was the best people you ever meet. They let people into their homes, and me and my wife have been talking about it, and I don't know that I could let strangers into my home like that. It's just something I've never done, so it'd be hard for me. But they did it, and I was thinking about how, just like here, when we have an event, all the volunteers are needed. Well, we go over there and we do something, and everybody's needed. It's just like the body of Christ. If you're a hand, you're needed. If you're a mouth, you're needed. And I'm just glad that the church thought enough of me to allow me to go be part of this, and I appreciate it. And I appreciate the people of Norwich for letting us come. And I'm not going to say nothing else about these people, the way they acted down there. Anyway, I was wondering what I would be good at, because I don't sing or dance, play instruments, but, you know, they found places for me. Mm-hmm. And so I'm just glad the Lord did use me, and I appreciate y'all again for letting us go.
Yeah. Tim, just like Bob and myself, we can add to our resume, we have acted in England before. We have been actors in plays and stuff in England. But your team did extremely well. And as you have mentioned, Tim, that Miss Charlotte made that same comment this morning about there's a place for everybody. And there was a place for everybody to pitch in. You know, one of the things that struck me the most, you saw that big tent that they had, that they had rented that tent and placed that in the middle of a park, which had to go through. You had to get permission to be able to do anything to do. And the city council had to approve all of those things. And what are you doing? And they had to talk about what they had to do. But, you know, one night when we did the line dancing, they think all of us as Americans, we line dance. That's just an American thing. I had to tell them there are certain people who do, and then there are certain people who don't. And that's a good thing for you, those that don't. But I was the DJ that night, and so I didn't have to dance. But I noticed they had to actually take the walls up on the side of the tent because there were so many people that showed up for that. And it was an opportunity for them to do something for the community. And about two-thirds of those people who showed up were not affiliated with their church whatsoever. I mean, they were completely new people. And so the church was able to make those contacts. And so we're so grateful for the partnership with Surrey Chapel. Probably some of them are actually watching us right now online. And so we had to make sure our grammar was good before we said anything. But if you are from Surrey Chapel and watching, we love you and we thank God for you. And we look forward to seeing you again, because you saw there. They're looking forward to doing it again next year. And so we're hoping that next year, Lord willing, in July of next year, we will send another team to go and to serve alongside them as they seek to reach the community that God has placed them in there in Norwich, England. But thank you so much, church, for allowing that to take place. So let me pray for us, and we'll continue our time of worship this morning. Father, thank you for this moment that we have. God, we thank you for the opportunity that you've given us in the past. But Lord, we look forward to what the opportunities will be for us in the future. And we, Lord, we know that as you desire, Lord, we will follow you and we will do what you've called us to do. Lord, in this moment of time, if we have to gather as a church, Lord, I pray that as we worship you, that we worship you with all of our hearts. God, that as we open up your word in just a moment, God, that you would speak to us as you have never spoken before, Lord, with clarity, we would understand the truths that you have for us in your word. May the songs of our heart be poured out. Lord, may we worship you in everything that we do. And God, we pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
A little earlier this morning, you asked the Lord to open your eyes, open the eyes of your hearts. Let's just affirm that this morning as we sing this hymn together and turn our eyes, literally turn our eyes upon the Lord. Would you stand as we lift this hymn together? Let's look afresh into the face of Christ.
Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face. And the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace.
Jesus, we turn our eyes to you. We ask that you open the eyes of our hearts, that we might see the fullness of who you are and be able to enjoy the victory that you grant. God, I pray as we have lifted you up, God, that you have inhabited the praises of your people, and that even now you would call us to your word, equip us with it, empower us with it, bind us to it, that we may know you and know you only. We give you glory for it in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. According to Psychology Today, there's an article that they released back in 2008, and the title of that particular article was, "How Many Decisions Do We Make Every Day?" And that's kind of a neat question to ask, but in that article, they suggested that a person will make 35,000 decisions every day. And I kept thinking to myself, there is no way in the world I make 35,000 decisions every day. But as I was sitting at lunch yesterday at our island, I was eating my ham sandwich and eating my bag of chips. I began to think, every time I reach into that bag, there was a conscious decision I had to make to whether I need to get another potato chip or not, right? So there are some of those decisions. They add up pretty quickly there. And so what that looks like, that's roughly 2,000 decisions per hour. One decision every 2 seconds. Now, there may be a lot of debate about whether that number is accurate or not, and we don't really know for sure. But from the moment that you and I open our eyes, when we wake up every morning, our lives are filled with choices and decisions that we have to make. And even if those numbers are not exactly right, maybe they're off even just a little bit, it's still an overwhelming number of decisions that we make each and every day. And obviously we know that some of those decisions are very significant decisions. They're big decisions, and they have real impact on our lives. John Maxwell, who's a leadership guru, he said this, "Life is a matter of choices, and every choice you make makes you." Now, here's what I want to ask. If someone asks you this morning, how do you make decisions? How would you answer that question? How do you make decisions? Now, I'm not talking about the small, insignificant choices of whether or not we're to reach our hand in that bag and to put another potato chip in our mouth. I am talking about the significant life choices that affect our lives. How do you make those decisions in life? And people answer that question, and when they answer that question, they're all over the place when they answer that question. Maybe some of these things resonate with you this morning about how you make decisions. Some of you out there, some people make decisions with a pro and con list. You'll get a piece of paper, you'll draw a line right down the middle of it, you'll put pros on one side, and you'll put the cons on the other side. And as you begin to list the pros and cons, you begin to see which one outlasts the other there, and whatever wins, that's kind of how you make that decisions. Other people will make those decisions or significant life decisions by opinion poll. They will ask everybody in their family, their close friends, people that they know best, ask them, what decision do you think I should make? And the majority vote, actually, that's how they make that decision. Anybody, does that sound familiar to some of you today? Or some people make the decision by just answering what makes me happy. I'm going to look at what I think makes me the happiest, and whatever I think that's going to make me happiest, that's how I'm going to make the decision before me. Other people make the decision by what just feels right. I just felt like the right thing to do in the moment, that's what I should do. And there are a lot of people that make decisions that particular way, and they feel their way through life. A lot of Christians use the old open door philosophy. That's how they make decisions. Well, it was just an open door, and when the door is open, I just step through it without ever asking the question, who's the one that opened the door, right? That's how they make decisions. And when all else fails, some of you go old school. and you pull out your magic eight ball, and you shake your magic eight ball up. Should I cash out my 401k and buy a motorcycle? And you pull your magic eight ball out, and it says, my sources say no. That's what it says. And that's kind of how you make decisions and to get where you're getting. But really, seriously, how do you make significant life choices? Last week, we looked at the definition of the word acceptable. And I said that the word acceptable is defined as being considered by most people to be reasonable or something that can be allowed. I'm sorry, I don't have the definition for you on the screen. But here's the reality. For many Christians, one of the things that I just described, or one of the processes that I just described for us this morning, is for many Christians, one of the ways that they make decisions, and it's become an acceptable way to make decisions. Whether it be pros or cons, whether what makes me happy, what just feels right, what a friend say, where the open door is. Never really ever wrestling with the question, does it matter to God how I make these decisions? Never even considering that. And what we do is that we will make a decision and pray and ask God to bless it. And so we get our own plans. We lay our own plans out there. We use one of these philosophies that I've just mentioned of the pros and cons or what feels right. But as soon as I make my decision, I'm going to take my decision to the Lord. And I'm going to say, God, now will you bless my decision? And not only am I going to do that, I'm going to enlist my friends to ask God to bless my decision. Does it really matter then how we make decisions if we're just going to do it all and all in the same way? But this morning, we're continuing our walk through the study through the New Testament book of James, written by the half-brother of Jesus. And what James is dealing with here in this passage of Scripture this morning is the idea of how we make decisions. And so let's jump in. James chapter 4, we're going to start in verse 13. And we're going to start off with just those first two words. He says, come now. And so before we just kind of gloss over, James, what he's doing here is he's grabbing us on both sides of the face and he's pulling us in close. And he's saying, listen to me. This is an imperative. This is a command. It's James trying to help us to lean in and to pay closer attention. And this is what he says, come now, you who say today or tomorrow, we will go into such and such a place and town and spend a year there and trade and make a profit. Yet you do not know what tomorrow will bring. What is your life? For you are a mist that appears for a little time and then vanishes. Instead, you ought to say, if the Lord wills, we will live and do this or that. As it is, you boast in your arrogance. All such boasting is what? Yeah, you see the same word I see. It's a strong word right there. But it's the word that we have to deal with nonetheless. The word evil means morally bad. One scholar says it means to be actively evil, meaning this, when we live like this, when we live in disregard as it pertains to the decisions in our lives this way, the Bible says here it's literally evil in action. Now that word evil is the very word that's used as the name of Satan himself. And there are three particular places in the New Testament. Satan is called the evil one, using the exact same words here that James is describing. So it's not just something that's not the best. What he's describing is a lifestyle that God, in essence, calls evil. Now, if you remember from last week, I told you, James is about to get into our business. This idea of acceptable sins, things that the Bible calls evil, the Bible calls sin. But many of us as Christians have begun to consider these things as, oh, it's okay. It's not that big of a deal. Now, last week, if you remember, we talked about speaking evil against one another, how that's just become commonplace in Christian culture, particularly when it relates to social media. And we just talk bad about our brothers and sisters in Christ. And James told us last week that there's never, ever, ever an acceptable moment for us to do such a thing. And now James is beginning to take it a step further, and he begins to deal with another acceptable sin that we see here. And you say, well, what is the acceptable sin that we see here? It's the sin of presumption. So what is that? Well, let me give you a definition of the sin of presumption. The sin of presumption is making life choices apart from seeking and submitting to the will of God. Now, here's what James says. This is not Pastor Greg's words here. This is James saying. He's saying, if you and I treat the decisions of our lives as if God doesn't even exist, it's evil. Pretty strong words. James says the people in the text here, the people that he is describing, they say, we will go and we will trade and we will spend time and we will make a profit. And he's talking to believers here about a cavalier attitude. The attitude of making decisions apart from submitting and seeking the will of God. These people are presuming, first of all, on the wind. They're saying today or tomorrow. They're presuming on the where, to such and such town is what they say. They're presuming on the what, I'm going to do my business. And they're also presuming on the why, I'm going to make a profit. They were making major life choices, and there's the expectation that somehow that God is now obligated to bless, to provide, and supply. Hashtag blessed, right? But let me be transparent with you for a moment. I've been a pastor now for 24 years, and in those 24 years, most of the appointments that I've had on my calendar are when someone who's asking for counsel and they are in a bind because of them or someone close to them making a decision apart from seeking and submitting to God. That's where most of them come from. And I can't tell you how many times I've heard somebody say, you know, I didn't even really seek God before making this decision, but here I am now, what do I do? But when you study the life of Jesus in the Gospels, we see that the Christian life is not you and I living for Jesus. The Christian life is Jesus living his life in and through us. That's why he died for our sins. But we know that he rose again so that we, or that he could live his life and his spirit could live in and through you and I each and every day. So conformity to the image of Jesus is that my life begins to look more and more like his life looked. And when Jesus was on the earth, the consuming passion of his life was walking and in constant step with the will of the Father. Let me show you that in a few places. John chapter 4, verse 34. Jesus said to them, my food is to do the will of him who sent me and to accomplish his work. John chapter 5, verse 30. Jesus says, I can do nothing on my own. Listen, if Jesus, the sinless Son of God in the flesh, needed to say, I can do nothing on my own, how much more, friends, do you and I need to approach our decisions and our life choices saying, I can do nothing on my own? Then we get to John chapter 6, verse 38. Jesus says, for I have come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. So what's the point here? Making significant life choices without seeking and submitting to the will of God is the very opposite of Christ-likeness in the life of Jesus. It's the complete opposite. And yet I'm telling you, I watch Christians all the time. Well, this isn't a spiritual thing. I can make this decision on my own. Oh, if it's about my quiet time or about my small group or my church, I do need to pray about those things. But this is business. This is business. This is relationships. This is my family. This is my free time. And they make decisions without seeking and submitting to the will of God. And here's what James is saying. That's a very dangerous way to live your life. You say, well, why is it so dangerous? Well, that's what I want to ask us today. Here's the first overarching question that I want to ask us today. Why is presumption on God so dangerous? Well, James actually gives us four reasons, and there are actually more, but we're just going to deal with the four that James gives us here in our text. And here's the first. It's dangerous, first of all, because our perspective is limited. When you and I make decisions that are apart from seeking and submitting to the will of God, you and I, we need to understand our perspective is limited. James said here in verse 14, yet you do not know what tomorrow will bring. That word know there is a common word. We know that. It knows to know by experience, to know by acquiring information. It means to be aware of a specific fact or piece of information. Listen to the way that the Amplified Bible translates it. Yet you do not know the least thing about what will happen tomorrow. And that speaks a lot to us because we don't. Life is uncertain. If you believe that, say amen. Amen. If you don't believe that, just continue to live for a little bit longer and you'll figure that out, right? There are stuff that happened today that you and I didn't plan for. There is stuff that's going to happen tomorrow that we didn't have on our agenda. There's stuff that's going to happen this week that we didn't see coming at all. Life is uncertain, and when you make life decisions without seeking God's will, you're choosing to make decisions that could change your life and the life of those that you love. Without all the information, here's the bottom line. You and I don't know what we don't know. Now, some of y'all will get that at lunchtime today, but we don't know what we don't know. Whatever decision you're on the brink of making, there's some stuff on the other side of that decision that you didn't see, you're not aware of, you don't have access to that information. But here's what I want you to know. God's perspective is not only unlimited, He's in absolute control. Let me show you something out of the book of Job, chapter 28, verse 24. For He looks to the ends of the earth and sees everything under the heavens. That can either bring us great comfort or it can scare us to death. Meaning this, there is nothing that escapes the wisdom and the knowledge and the power and the control of God. Nothing. Doesn't it just make sense, though, that if you and I have access to the one whose perspective is unlimited, who's sovereign and is in complete control, shouldn't we ask Him on the front side of making that decision? James says our perspective is limited. But not only is our perspective limited, our flesh is deceitful. The text says we're going to go and we're going to make a profit. And the story James is using here as an illustration, one in which he's probably seen played out even in the first century church. There are these people that are saying, here's what we're going to do. We're going to make these decisions. We're going to go and we're going to make a profit while we're doing that. And that word, the phrase make a profit, it's a word that means to gain. And it usually is describing something that's a financial or a material gain. And what it's describing is a people who are consumed with a lust for more. How many times, friends, do we make decisions just because we want more? How much is more? Just a little bit more. Is it wrong to have more? No, that's not the answer. But here's what the Bible is saying with certainty for us this morning. You and I are to be content with what we have. If God in His sovereignty and as a part of His plan chooses to enable us to have more, to God be the glory. But listen, this is very much an American value, this consuming passion and drive for more, to have more. But the longing to have more is just a cup with a hole in the bottom of it. However more you get, it's going to leak out. And no matter what level that you get to, the flesh will always say, I just need a little bit more. And here's what we got to know about the flesh. The flesh, it will lie to us. It's deceitful. You remember what Jeremiah said in Jeremiah 17:9? The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately sick. Who can understand it? So this idea of following our heart is blasphemy. Follow the will of God. So here's what that means. Your heart, my heart, will lie to me. Meaning this, when the motivation of my decision is if this is going to make me happy, there's a hole in the bottom of that cup. It won't last. It won't fulfill. It won't satisfy. When the decision being made is what just feels right, it can often lead to regret. And regret can be avoided by seeking and submitting to the will of God in every decision of my life. And as I look back on my life in those moments of regret, let me tell you what I did. I got out in front of God. I got out in front of God on that decision and expected God's blessing and protection and favor to just follow whatever Greg wanted to do. And I didn't wait to hear from God. So our flesh will lie to us. But thirdly, the reason why being presumptuous on God is dangerous is that our time is short. Look at verse 14 again. What is your life? He says, for you are a mist that appears for a little time and then vanishes. That word we see there, mist, it's a word that means vapor. It's like when you have a kettle or a pot on the stove and the steam begins to rise off of that pot and it's there and then it's just gone. Or it's like the breath of air on a cold morning when you're outside. You walk outside and you can see your breath for just a moment, and then what happens? Your breath, it's gone. James says, if you look at everything in life in view of eternity, our lives are a mist that appears for a little time, and then whew, it's gone. That'll humble us. That means I'm not really as important as I thought I was. You see, we often make plans as if our time is unlimited. When we often make plans thinking, oh, I got plenty of time to do that. I know the Lord wants me to do that, but I wanna do this first, and then I'll get around to that. It's like as if we think that we're in control of how much time we have. James says it's limited. The great preacher Warren Wiersbe said it this way: since life is so brief, we cannot afford merely to spend our lives, and we certainly do not want to waste our lives. We must invest our lives in those things that are eternal. Our time, friends, is short. But here's the fourth reason it's dangerous to presume on God: our enemy is a liar. Look at verse 15 there. And that little phrase that we see there in the middle, if the Lord wills. A lot of times we hear that phrase, God's will, and we buy into the lie of the enemy. And here's what the enemy will tell you. God's will is going to rob you of all joy and all freedom. That's what the enemy will tell you. It's kind of like Eeyore on Winnie the Pooh. I know that I got to do God's will, but I really don't want to do it. But I know that I got to do God's will. That's kind of the way we act. It's kind of like we think the will of God is like eating your vegetables. We know that it's good for, but we don't want to do it, right? The Bible says this about our enemy. John chapter 8, verse 44. This is Jesus speaking. When he lies, he speaks out of his own character, for he is a liar and the father of all lies. But the Bible also tells us in Romans chapter 12, verse 2, Paul speaking here, he says, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what the will of God is, what is good and acceptable and perfect. That word good means best. Acceptable means giving pleasure and satisfaction. Perfect means perfect. The enemy says the will of God is going to rob you. It's going to make you sad. It's going to make you sacrifice. It's going to bring you down. But the Bible says God's will is the best. God's will is going to satisfy and give you pleasure. And God's will leave you wanting for nothing. That's why James says it's dangerous to presume on God. But that leads us to our second question. The second question is this: what's the alternative to presuming on God? And I said it earlier, the sin of presumption is making life choices apart from seeking and submitting to the will of God. But here's the alternative: making life choices through seeking and submitting to the will of God. And so here's what you need to know, friends, and I hope that you understand this. Do you know that the creator and the sustainer of the universe loves you? Think about that. He loves you. And wrapped up in that love is this glorious, glorious purpose for your life. But listen, he will not force that purpose or that plan on you. We are not his robots. We are in a relationship with him. And as his followers, he has a plan, but he'll graciously allow us to presume and do our own thing. And by doing that, you and I miss out on the glorious plan that God has for our lives. So there's two aspects of this alternative that we got to understand. And I want to show it to you in two different statements. The first there, back in verse 15, again back, if the Lord wills. Now, do you see the contrast here? You had this group going, we're going to do whatever we want to do. But then James changes it and he says, if the Lord wills. The opening part of the story, they said that we're going to do all of these things. We're going to go. We're going to do it today and tomorrow. We're going to stay a year. We're going to do some work. We're going to make a profit. Now, James says, here's the way you do it. If the Lord wills, then we will. You see, the phrase speaks to the heart. It speaks to the posture of the heart that is surrendered to the will of God, no matter what it might be. And that's the heartbeat of Jesus. Do you remember when he was in the Garden of Gethsemane, the cry that he made when Jesus there on the brink of the crucifixion? You remember what he says in Mark chapter 14? And he said, Abba, Father, all things are possible for you. Remove this cup from me, yet not what I want, but what you will, what you desire. That relationship decision, friends, that you're about to make, that family decision that you're about to make, that relocation decision that you're about to make, that selling of the house decision, whatever it may be, have you reached a posture of the heart that says, Lord, here's my cry? And Jesus said it, Lord, here's my cry. Now what I want, not what I want, because my perspective is limited on the fleshly side, on the human side. I can't see what you see, and Lord, I know my flesh will lie to me. What I want may not be what I need. You ever thought about that? Lord, I know that I've got an enemy that lies to me. Lord, I know my time is short. I may be making a decision that I don't even have time to see it lived out. And we need to realize when we are truly seeking the will of God, he does not, and he will not reveal his will as just an option for us. Sometimes we want to lay out the will of God beside all the other options that are out there, and we reserve the final decision for ourselves. And we only follow the will of God if we think that that's our best option. We must be willing to follow it no matter what it might be. And if you believe, friends, listen to me. If you believe that Jesus is Lord, say, raise your hand. Let me see your hand. Okay. Good job. You know I'm fixing to back you into a corner, though, right? Lord means boss. Lord means one in charge. Meaning Lord and anything but yes don't go together. Lord, I'll pray about it. And if it feels good or fits into my schedule, or I think it'll make me happy, then I'll do it. Stop. If we're ever going to know the will of God, if we're ever going to experience God's best, if we're going to please him in all our decision, it begins with a heart that is submitted to his will that says, God, I have died to myself. I understand that I'm describing something that's not easy for us. It's not easy at all. It's challenging. It's hard. But when you and I realize what we're laying down to pick up, submitting to his desires in a room like this today, there's some big decisions that are being faced all around this room. There's some life-altering decisions in front of us. Are you ready to say, God, here's my request, but I submit to you not my will, but yours? But here's the second part of that statement in verse 15. If the Lord wills, we will live and do this or that. Submission is about the heart. It's a surrender. It's seeking and submitting to God. You see, when you and I make decisions apart from seeking and submitting to the will of God, that's presuming on God. But when I'm making decisions by submitting and seeking the will of God, now I'm in dependence on Him, which is what we call faith. As a Christian, the Bible says without faith, it is impossible to please God. Nothing we do pleases Him apart from living in dependence on Him. Listen to what Paul writes in Romans chapter 10, verse 17. So faith comes from what? Hearing, and hearing from the word of Christ. And here's what that means. If you haven't heard from God, it's not faith. How many times have I heard, well, I'm not really sure what God wants me to do, so I'm just gonna step out on faith. Well, that's not faith. That's presumption on God, and it's a dangerous way to live your life and to lead your family. Faith comes by hearing, is what Scripture tells us. We must hear God, which means faith demands intimacy with God. What God has invited us into is not just a bunch of rules and regulations and religion. No, friends, He's invited us into a relationship. How then do I know God's will for my life? I got to submit my will. And then intimately, I've got to pursue Him. And as I pursue God, He makes Himself known through the vehicle of the relationship that I have with Him. And here's what I've learned in my life. Every time that I lack or have a lack of clarity or surrounding the will of God in my life, it's always for me an invitation to deeper intimacy with Him. And here's what that means. When I have a lack of clarity, it's not up to me to figure it all out and figure out what the will of God is. It's up to me at that point to pursue Him. And as I pursue Him, guess what happens? He makes His will known to me. A lack of clarity is an invitation to deeper intimacy with God. I love what Henry Blackaby said about this in Experiencing God. If you do not have clear instructions from God in a matter, pray. And we would love for that sentence to be over right there, but it's not, is it? If you do not have clear instruction from the Lord in a matter, pray, then what's it say? Y'all are impatient just like I am. Learn patience. Depend on God's timing. His timing is always right and best. Don't get in a hurry. He may be withholding directions to cause you to seek Him more intently. Don't try to skip over the relationship to get on with the doing. God is more interested in a lover relationship with you than He is in what you can do for Him. We've replaced busyness with intimacy. And so how do I know that I've heard from God? How do I know that I've submitted to the will of God? Well, there's no magical 1-2-3 formula that I have for you today, but there's a couple of things that I've learned over my life and of walking with the Lord through the years that I've identified things in my life that I look for. And I want to share those with you. I don't have them on a slide for you, but I do want to share them. One of those things that I look for is a word from the Word. What do you mean by that? Is that one of those things where you just grab your Bible and say, Lord, I need to know what you need to do, and then you just begin to flip randomly, and boom, you say, then the boundaries goes up to the valley of the sun. No, that's not what you do. That's not what I'm talking about there. In the regular rhythm of life, in your daily time alone with Jesus, you're in His Word, and God begins to speak to us through His Word, so we have a word from His Word. But second of all, is things what I call circumstances and even counsel in my life. The situation, the circumstances, and the counsel that I'm getting from others that are in alignment with the Word that I am getting from the Word. And here's the third thing. There's a sense of peace. A sense of rightness in my heart. I define it this way. It's the absence of a check in my spirit. And if you've been walking with the Lord for a number of years, you know what it is to have a check in your spirit about something. And here's what I'm telling you. Every time I walk past that check in my spirit, I have lived to regret it. Let me save you some heartache. When all of those things begin to line up and point in the same direction, a word from the Word, a sense of peace and right circumstances and counsel, when those things line up, then as followers of Jesus, we step out in faith at that point. And so we see this idea of the sin of presumption, presuming that God's going to do this and God's going to do this the way that I want Him to do that. That negates Him being God, and that makes you God. And maybe you're here today, and that's something that you need to repent of. You've just lived your life the way that you wanted to live, never considering what God's place is and for all of those things. And maybe today God is showing you, hey, buddy, I want to save you some heartache. Come to me first. Some of you here today, you've never done that before because you've never had a relationship with Jesus. And here's what you need to know today, is that the God of the universe, the creator and sustainer of the universe, invites you into a love relationship with Himself. And He wants to have a relationship with you. And we never are ever to substitute spiritual activity for the relationship that we have with Jesus. That's just being busy. But God has called us into intimacy in that relationship, and He's inviting you into that relationship today. And if you've never trusted Christ, in just a moment, as we sing our song of response, I'm going to be standing right here. I'd love to pray with you and pray for you. Or maybe you're, as a follower of Jesus, there are some things going on in your life that you need to give to the Lord. You've sought everybody else's counsel. You've done your pros and cons list. You figured out what makes me happy, what makes me feel good, all those things. The magic eight ball leaked all the fluid out, and you can't even use that anymore. But today, let's start where we should have started from the beginning, and that is taking it to the Lord. Let's pray. Father, thank You this day, Lord, that we have Your Word to be able to open and to walk through. Father, You have given us a word from Your Word, and Lord, we thank You for that. God, we thank You that You're a God who desires to have a relationship with us, who desires to have intimacy in every situation and circumstance in our life. And Father, I pray that as followers of You, Lord, that we would have the courage to lay down our desires and to pick up that which is good, acceptable, and perfect. Father, I pray for that one who's here today who does not have a relationship with You, God, that today will be the day, Lord, that You draw them to Yourself, that they would come to know You as Savior and Lord. Lord, during this time, You have Your perfect way. And Lord, we pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Friends, as we stand and sing our song of response, if you have a decision that you need to make today, I want to invite you to come. If you need to stay in your chair where you are, you do that as well. But let's sing together this morning.
You are my strength. You are my strength when I am weak. You are the treasure that I seek. You are my all in all. Seeking You as a precious jewel, but to give up I'd be a fool. You are my all in all. Jesus.
you're a guest with us, we're so glad that you chose to be here with us this morning. You'll find in the pew rack in front of you a connection card. And if you take that and fill that out. And out here in our Next Step Center, they will trade you a filled out connection card with a goodie bag. And so I want to encourage you to do that. Or you can drop it in one of the offering boxes before you leave today. You don't forget, you can worship through giving by dropping your offering in an offering box. Lots of things going on. We kind of made some adjustments to the bulletin this week. Did y'all notice that? Both of you that read the bulletin, I'm so proud of you. We had to go to a trifold. It's almost like COVID didn't happen anymore. Damn. I tried. They're ready to go. Lots of stuff going on in your bulletin. I am not going to read all those, but the main thing is this afternoon our children's choirs are kicking off. We have some discipleship training stuff starting at 5 o'clock today. We'd love for you to join us. Look there on the back, and you can see what we've got offered, and you can join alongside of us. Also, next weekend is our Shepherding a Child's Heart. It's a conference that some of our parents are going to in Clinton. If you have any questions about that, Pastor Tyler would be glad to be able to answer those questions for you. And then we've got our Sunday School Appreciation Banquet coming up on the 28th. That is for all outgoing and incoming teachers. So if you were a teacher last year, like 3 weeks ago, that means last year, we invite you to come and have dinner, our treat. We want to love on you and encourage you and congratulate you, but we need you to RSVP. You can RSVP on Realm or by calling the church office. But if you're a new teacher or you're teaching this year, we expect you to be there. We want you to be there because we're going to do some workshops, some training for about an hour or so after that, after we eat lunch, and so we encourage you to be there for that. Lots of stuff going on. One other thing that's not in your worship folder here is that something we've tried to work on the last couple of years with our nominating committee. We're trying to put together three teams, and they asked me to mention that. And these teams are our children's ministry team, student ministry team, and college ministry team. And those ministry teams are there to help predict a lot of them with Tyler, to help carry out the week-to-week functions that go and are involved in the student ministry and college ministry and even children's ministry. And if you're interested in serving in one of those, if you'll see Sean Brace, Sean is up there behind the camera today. He loves being behind the camera instead of in front of the camera. I'll trade with you one day. But you'll see Sean or see me, and we can get you to where you need to be. Is that a deal? All right, let's pray and we'll be dismissed. Father, thank you for the time together. Father, I thank you for a time in your word. God, I pray, Lord, as we leave this place that we would remember, Lord, that you have so much for us, Lord, and that we hold ourselves back. May we lay down those things that are imperfect and limited, and Lord, may we pick up those things that are perfect and are unlimited because you are in control. As we leave this place, use us for your glory and honor. In Jesus' name, amen.